diseases, whatever we've got. It's great to be here on a Sunday, but it's almost like after the meeting, we're back to normality. But normality, folks, is spiritual, eternal. We are children of God.
Amen.
And when we face those difficulties, we need to know that God is with us. We forget it when our problems come. We often run here, run there, worry, complain and fret when God says, don't be anxious. Does he? He does. Yes, he does. And so we often forget about God. It's amazing when we have problems, we talk to our friends, we talk to our Christian friends, we talk to our neighbours, and then we forget, oh, maybe I should have gone to God first. I've learned, I don't even know where, I've learned to praise God. Doesn't mean I don't have difficulties. Pastor Joe and Christine, they know some of the crushing life and death difficulties and circumstances and situation that Chris and myself are in, and our children and our grandchildren. We are in great difficulties, but we have a great God.
Amen.
Now he's better than that. We have a great God.
Amen.
And my daughter, because of problems with her grandson, it's not his fault. She's absolutely crushed, but she says, I'm still trusting God. And I want to tell you, that's worth more than gold. We need to remember why we are not living, we wonder why we are not living victorious lives of faith and hope. But God is not in all our thoughts, as one of the Psalms says. So we miss the most important ingredient in the comings and goings of our lives. When trouble comes, we need to turn to God. We turn to God with our oft-repeated prayer, help. But isn't it amazing? We usually wait till the last minute when we fretted and worried and had sleepless nights. I said to the band as I came in, where's Pastor Joe? He's not playing today. I said, you know, I didn't sleep last night worrying about his trumpet playing. I was only joking, Joe, honestly. But God wants to be and should be every part of our day. He's not there to be kept in a box or on a shelf. Listen, we're not Catholics, are we? If you are, well, talk to Pastor Joe afterwards. We don't go in the church and there's a little box with the Holy Spirit there and a little box where the Holy Spirit lives in us, doesn't he?
Amen.
Come on. We are eternal people. And God needs to be a part of the fabric of our lives every day. Our lives should be lives of praise and thanksgiving. Shouldn't it just?
Amen.
The Bible says, in everything give thanks, pray without ceasing. Rejoice evermore. But in the difficult times, that's when you do it. I learned to worship God. Listen, I love to worship. My fingers are itching for the keyboard, although I'm a terrible keyboard player. But I love to worship. Love the worship here. I love to worship. I love to pray in tongues. I love to sing. And we need to learn that when problems come, we lift our eyes to God and say, thank you, Lord. Because you are God, you are Father, you will not let me down, you will not fail me, you will not forsake me. I am a child of God.
Amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
For the blood of Jesus. God will never let you down, whatever you're going through, whatever you think. You might think, hang on a minute, I'm too this, it's too hard. Nothing's too hard for God.
Amen.
Nothing. I learned to worship in a hospital waiting room when a loved one was dying. I'd been told that they probably wouldn't last 5 minutes. And the Holy Spirit put a word into my spirit. And inside I erupted with joy. It was amazing. Well, praise God, that person didn't die and is still running around full of energy today.
Hallelujah.
That was 19 January 1984. That's when I learned to worship. Not in a school of worship. I'm a musician. I didn't go to a musical school to learn to worship. It's what's inside, isn't it?
Amen.
But you need to learn to let it out. Well, I can't sing. Never mind. Just sing.
Amen.
Just go for it. Let the Holy Spirit rise up in you. Well, I feel terrible. I feel depressed. I feel that if I can't go another step forward, that's the time to lift your voice and say, hallelujah. God is good. He'll bless you. Sahab al Akoru. You don't have to interpret that bit. Whose side are you on? Are you an ally or an adversary? I know this place has a proud but difficult history of war, because I remember being here 50 years ago. Where's the years gone? I don't look 68, do I?
No.
Who said yeah? One truthful person. I remember coming here. I remember seeing the Newark Royal. It was about 67, 68. I remember seeing the Ark Royal coming into the Grand Harbour. It was an amazing sight. Of course, it's been scrapped now. It's so long ago. I remember you could barely see the water of the Grand Harbour for the Italian fleets and the American fleets and, of course, the British fleets. You'd have the American 5th or 6th fleet, the Italian fleet. The place was buzzing. I'm not going to mention anything about Mintoff. I didn't know the other guy. What was his name? Borgia Olivier. His granddaughter, as well, worked in my gym in Acton. I heard somebody say, "Oh, Borgia, are you Borgia Olivier?" I said, "I know. What was his name?
George.
And I knew him and I knew his dad. And he said, "Oh, it's my grandfather." I said, "Wow." But this place has a proud history of warfare. I wonder, is God on the German side or on the British side? Is he on the Syrian side or the Israeli side? Is he on this side or that side? I want to tell you, God is on nobody's side. God is on his own side. Whose side are you on? Right. Are you on your side, their side, my side, his side? We're on the Lord's side. So Josh saw this man and he said, "Are you for us or against us? Who are you?" He was obviously a little bit worried. He didn't have his hundreds and hundreds of thousands of troops to protect him. Who are you? In the First World War, there's a fantastic illustration that this man, though, had a sword drawn. In the First World War, there's a great story of Christmas Day, when the German and the British troops were in the trenches shooting each other, killing each other, a great slaughter and terrible bloodshed and disease. And the moment Christmas Day came, the two opposing armies jumped up in the middle and started playing football. Isn't that amazing? Whose side is God on? Ours? No. He's not on your side. In Exodus 32:26-27, we have the story that Moses has come down from the mountain with the tablets of stone, with the Ten Commandments, and he finds that the multitude have rebelled and they've made a golden calf. Isn't it amazing how fickle people are? Isn't it amazing how quickly people move off from the true faith? It really is. I see it in churches. People I've known that have been ministers have got fallen away. Wow! Christians that I knew well, they've fallen away. Never darken a church door. They'll blame this person, that person. But hey, listen, we're following Jesus. We're not following Pastor Joe. And joking aside, I want to tell you this, my friend here is not perfect. Oh, you're all shocked. Nor am I, nor are you. Only Jesus. We're not here to follow the pastor. We follow him as he follows Jesus. We're not here to follow God, follow the leaders. We're here to follow them under God, because we put our trust in Jesus.
Amen.
And if you were looking for the perfect church, you need to leave, because I once went to the perfect church once and spoiled it. There's no such thing. We're living and working and praising and worshipping together to build God's church. It's not your church, it's His.
Amen.
You may have paid for the building, God bless you. Pastor Joe may have worked to build this church and start this church, but it's still the church of Jesus Christ, purchased with His blood. We're not on His side, we're on the Lord's side. So they came down and there was the golden calf. Levi said, "The people made me do it." No, they didn't. They were dancing around naked. Oh, they were terrible people. And then Moses said, who is on the Lord's side? Who is on the Lord's side? And the Levites stood up and they said, we're on the Lord's side. And and Moses said, go and slaughter. Amazing thing to do. And you think, that's awful, that's terrible. But God needs to root out sin. I remember a story of a man in the East End in the early 1900s. He was born again and he was an ex-boxer. And he used to get drunks and demon-possessed people in his church. And he used to give them a good hiding and throw them out. He hadn't come round to getting demons sorted by then. Who's on the Lord's side? Is he on my side when I have a disagreement in church? Not that you do, because you're all perfect, aren't you? Amen. But I have to say, I'm very disappointed. There are a number of people here, not here, that were here a few years ago. Is he on my side when I have a disagreement with work colleagues? You see, God was not on Abraham or Moses, Daniel, Jeremiah's side. They were on his side. I'm a Leicester City supporter. I've been mocked for years in Acton where I live, Queen's Park Rangerland. Oh, I know nothing about football. I'm a Leicester City supporter. Well, we won this year. Hallelujah. But those players, it's not about them. It's about the club. It's about the city. It's not about us. They were on his. God was merely working out his plan and purpose for Israel through each of those men. God is working out his plan and purpose in your life, for Malta, for the Word of Life Church, for your street, for your workplace. God has a plan and a purpose. So many of us Christians, we just wander through life. We think like Jesus is like, or God is like Father Christmas. Lord, I need a new car. I need a new house. I've got problems. I need healing. My family needs saving. All of these are valid, but at the end of the day, God is not like a Father Christmas. God is not here to just lift us up and make us happy. God is not here to make all our problems disappear. As I started off with, we need those difficulties in order to grow in faith.
Amen.
I used to be a runner. I used to run 40 miles a week, then I couldn't run on the road, and I had to run in the gym. But I could still run 40 miles a week. I'd still run 10 miles on the treadmill on a Saturday in 77 minutes, which wasn't bad for a 65, 66-year-old. And 2 years ago, I found out that actually the reason I got pain in my back with my arthritis is because I was still running. I had to stop running. And, you know, you have plans for that. And you have to take hold of all these difficulties and allow God to work out his plans and purpose for your life. And so God was working out his plan and purpose for Israel through them, ensuring that out of Judah his Messiah, Christ Jesus, would come. God had a plan. He knew what was going to happen in the millennia that was to come. He knew that in all of that children of Israel, in everything that he did with Isaac, even through Abraham, everything that God did, he was working towards a plan. You know that, didn't you? Amen. You know that when the tribe of Judah came, when Judah was born, God could see his son Jesus being born into that tribe and salvation coming for us today. God is not just day specific. He doesn't live for today or tomorrow. He's not just here to get you out of your difficulties. But God has a plan and a purpose, an eternal plan and a purpose for each one of you, from the youngest child here to the oldest person. I've an idea that's me. Yet so many Christians, oh, we go to church on Sunday, Yes, now and again we talk to our friends about Jesus. Oh yes, well we're living our lives, but we love Jesus. We're going to church. God gives us money when we need it. God gives us nice cars. But no, that's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. God has a plan for your life. And maybe you're just breezing through your Christian life. We need to get to God and say, God, what is your plan and purpose for my life? What am I here for? Well, I'm here, what did the Anglicans say? I can't remember. I'm here to praise God and worship God. I don't know, but we are here to live for Jesus. But we are here to be light and salt and light in the world. I'm a little bit of a hardliner. My dear pastor, I work part-time now. As you know, I'm semi-retired in my church. We've got a church of 1,000 in Ealing. And you know, I retired 2 years ago. You remember how happy I was? Well, now I'm working part-time. And I visit the old people. I visit people that are sick in house, but I'm not necessarily old. I run a Wednesday afternoon fellowship meeting for mainly old people. And I wonder whether I'm one of them. I probably am. God is really blessing us. But I noticed, I realized after a while, because I visit the people that are sick and dying in hospital, some get healed, some don't, I realize I'm the one that does the funerals. This year, I've conducted, preached at, or I've done everything but pick up a spade, 13 funerals this year. And a memorial service, and I've had to do the funeral for some of my dear, dear friends. And so I retired, and I'm in this large church with about 1,000. Pastor Joe was there in January, February, March, whenever he came. I can't remember when he came. I was just glad to get rid of him. I mean, I was so pleased to have him stay with us. Sorry, did I say that? I'm old, Joe. My mind, sometimes I say things, I, you know. But you see, my heart, I'm a preacher, maybe not a brilliant preacher, but I've been preaching for 44 years. I love to minister, I love to pray for people, I love to pray for the sick. I see people healed. God is good. That's my ministry. I'm not clever like Pastor Joe. I don't have degrees. I'm only on the hot water. You know, God has called me into a new ministry. And I seem to be successful, except for all my people are dying. So, you know what? I've run out of people to visit now. They're all gone. My colleagues say, don't come and visit us, Pastor Bob. We don't want to die. I was visiting a guy about 20 miles out, and he broke his leg, and then a guy from Clarence, a lovely Asian guy. And I took the senior pastor's PA, an elder, an African guy called Akin. I said, come with me, Akin, you want to see him? Yeah, so we went off in my car. And he texted one of the pastors, the missionary pastor, to say, oh, I'm just going off with Pastor Bob to visit Clarence. And he texted back, and he'd been sick, don't let him come to visit me. I want to live. And it's amazing how I'm not doing what I wanted to do. Before I was leaving, a lady who was a pastor, an American lady, she said, when you leave, Bob, you come to my fellowship. I can introduce you to lots of pastors around England. You'll be preaching every Sunday. I've got people that love to take you to Africa, to India, take you abroad on missions. I've seen your ministry. I want to get you out there. I thought, wow, that's just what I want. But then inside I felt this is not what God wants. And I turned my back and what I really want, I said, Chris, I'm not going to do that. She says, what? She said, you never wanted to be a pastor. You've always wanted to do this, didn't you? Why? I said, because I don't believe. It's not about me, it's about Jesus. What's God want for me? We didn't even know when I retired what church we were going to, or the Lord hadn't told us. I even wanted to go to a different town, a quieter town, a little bit further out of London. I was just thinking about it, get a little bit of peace and rest. And we went to our local Ealing church, as it happens, the one I'm now in. And the pastor said to me, oh, Bob, what are you doing? Oh, I've retired, Richard. No, you never retire in the kingdom of God. Come and work for me. I said, no, I've been working since I was 14. I left school at 14. I've been working 51 years. It's 53 now. I gave him, he said, I need somebody to work part time. And we'd said, we're waiting for God to open doors. When God opened doors, you can't tell him what to open. Is that right?
Amen.
Some of you may in your spirit feel that God is leading you and you're thinking, but I don't want to do it. Well, I tell you, I don't want to do it. But I'm the most fulfilled I've ever been. I'm so loved. I know you're thinking, when's this guy going to go? No, but I'm so loved. I'm so appreciated. It's amazing. Because you guys, I know this is a wonderful church, but I've been in churches where I've got scars in my back where people have stabbed me. Not literally, of course. And the things that I've put up with over all these years as a pastor. But God has moved me on. And I'm doing what I never thought I'd do. When they said, I want you to do the visiting, I said to Chris, I'm the worst visitor in the world. She said, you are. Because I talk. But I'm a prophet. That's what my bosses said. So I like to go in. I'm not interested in what you've got to say. I want to tell you what God is saying. Come on. Now most people, I want to talk to somebody. Oh, it's so awful. Oh, it's so dreadful. I say, don't mark. You've got a wonderful God. He's going to do something in your life. Oh, and what people want to talk. Have you noticed that? But not me. I don't want to listen. I want to hear what God has to say. And so I'm having an incredibly successful life. But it's not what I wanted. If you'd have asked me years ago, what's God going to do for you? I would have never have thought that's where God wanted me. But God, but I'm on the Lord's side. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's not about what I want. It's not about what my wife wants, my family wants. What does God want? Because when we're doing what God wants, He will put everything else into place. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all of these things. They've been talking about finance. But it can do with health. It can do with all of these things. Everything you need. It's everything. When you're seeking God. Next week I want to bring a message from Romans 5. That's if you have me back. But about Romans 5. About the God of the much more. And so Moses got there. And there was the golden calf. The people had turned from God very quickly. Whose side are we on? But I want to tell you, God is working out a plan and purpose for your life, for your family. And you don't know that there might be things that you're doing, I don't mean even sin, but there might be things that you're involved with that's stopping the blessing of God. And you're thinking, why isn't this working out for me? Well, see, God. Maybe God has something else for you. We need to know that we're here for God. We are here as Pentecostal people to be listening, as our brother said during the communion, to be listening. What's the Holy Spirit saying to me? What is the Holy Spirit saying to me? Because I want to tell you, there's lots of times I know what I'm doing, and I know what I think I'm doing, and I know what I want to do, and then the Holy Spirit cuts through and says, do this. And I'm thinking, but Lord, and I do what He says, and people are healed, or revelation comes, or something happens. Where lives are changed. Is that because I'm wonderful? No. It's because I listen to the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Or there might be a financial need. I was led by the Holy Spirit to give a smallish amount of money. But money all the same to somebody. And they said, oh, Pastor Bob, that's so nice of you. It was done in quiet. But I had to tell the elder, it's so nice of you. I said, no, it's nothing to do with being nice. I'm just being obedient. That opened the road of blessing into somebody else's life. But it also rebounded on me. It's about, not about you. It's not even about your family. When you seek God, the Bible says, when you build His house, He will build yours.
Amen.
And sometimes it seems the toughest thing to do. And that it seems so unreasonable. God says, do something. Even if it's about changing in your life. And you think, this is so hard. This can't be right. And yet God just releases something into your life, into your family. It's about God. What plan and purpose does God have for your life, for your family, for your church, and for your nation? Because you guys here, I don't know the other churches here, I'm from that evangelical churches that don't interest me, I don't know them. But I've been here in this church since the days of the double garage. When Mark was a little lad. You know when Pastor Joe had more hair. When Christine was just as beautiful as she was then. I don't know, what are you taking? If you want some special pills or just beauty, is it? of this church. I've visited this church. So I have an investment. I love you guys. Some of you are Facebook friends, aren't you? I think you are. What's God's plan? What's God's plan for this church? You see, there's so many of you here, and I think not everybody's here, I don't think. There's so many of you. You could change this nation. Is Malta a nation? Is Malta a nation? Oh, sorry. You could change this nation. You could change this nation.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
You could change this nation.
Amen. Amen.
You don't know what God can do. You know, there's a saying around that irritates me. If you keep doing things the same way as you've always done, nothing will change. Have you heard all those sound bites? That's rubbish. That's psychology. Oh, you wouldn't teach it. No, you wouldn't. No. You keep doing, keep doing, keep doing. Keep at it, keep at it, keep believing. And God will bring the increase. Amen?
Amen.
I hear all these ministers and that. That's psychology. The Holy Spirit, you just keep going, keep praying, keep believing, keep fasting, keep giving, keep trusting. And one day, the Holy Spirit will come. Because it's God's time, it's God's plan, it's God's purpose. And you'll see a breakthrough in this place. I think I've lulled them all to sleep, John. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Maybe I'm prophesying. It's the same with your lives. Keep doing it. Keep praying. Keep believing. When your children are away from the Lord, when your children are not doing what you want, when your grandchildren, God be my age, when things are not working how you'd hoped, just keep trusting. Just keep believing. It's not about you. It's not about you. It's about God. What is God's plan and purpose? See, I learned to pray that bit from the Lord's Prayer. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. And I've seen amazing answers to prayer. Not my will. What does it say in John about salvation? Not the will of man. Not the will of flesh. Not the will of your relatives. Not the will of the devil. Just God's will.
Amen.
And I am determined, brothers and sisters, that I want God's will to be done in my life. I want God's will to be done in my family. And I tell you, sometimes when you want God's will in your life, you've got to lay your will down first.
Amen.
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 I've probably said that before. When you, and I've prayed this, I've used that framework to pray in my churches, and we've seen the most amazing manifestation of the presence of God and answers to prayer. I don't want my will to be done in my children. I don't want my will to be done in my grandchildren. I want the will of God.
Amen.
You see, we've got to be eternal in our vision and not just be looking at things as though they were. God has a plan and a purpose. And so all through the Bible, the Old Testament, God wasn't just going along willy-nilly, as we say. He was working out his plan. Every generation of Jews, every generation was coming up to the time when Jesus was to be born. So that mankind would be saved. It wasn't about Moses. It wasn't about all the other great men of God. And it isn't about you and me today. You have a life to fulfill for God.
Amen.
It wasn't an accident when you were born again. When you met the person you met who told you about Jesus and brought you out of unbelief or idolatry. It wasn't an accident the day you walked down the street and bumped into that person. It was a designed and planned by God. Listen, I want to tell you that I'm the child, the illegitimate child of a prostitute. My father was a client. And you'd have thought, oh my goodness, what a beginning. And I was an accident. No, I wasn't. God saw today.
Amen.
In those days, years ago, over 68 years ago, God saw that day. And God brought me forth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm not an accident. I'm not just the produce of a financial transaction. God is a good God.
Amen.
I remember I was at Kensington Temple. It's a big, big, big church in West London. And it was the first mega church. It was a church of 5,000 in 1990. The first mega church in Great Britain. And I was there. My church was part of that network. And one Wednesday night, we'd been called out as pastors to pray for people after the service, and I'm standing there back to the platform, and I asked the Lord, I said, who should I pray for, Lord? I like to ask. And he said, pray for that lady. She was a little dumpy lady, about that height and about that wide. And I went to her and said, oh, come on, I'd like to pray for you. She said, and the funny thing was, she had a little West Indian lady who was like a matchstick lady standing behind her ready to catch her. She was so thin, her name was Doreen. But this lady, I said, how can I minister to you today, sister? That was nice. Hi, my name's Bob, yeah? And she said, oh, I was abandoned as a child. And I said, that's wonderful. And she looked at me as if, well, where's your compassion? I said, that's one of all those thousand people in that place. That woman came to me who had been abandoned. I was abandoned twice. And she came to me and I said, you know what, so was I. But if I hadn't have been where I was then, I won't be where I am today. Amen. Do you ever complain and say, oh, I've had a hard life, how difficult my life was, I was abused, I was beaten, I was divorced, I was this, I was that, we were poor, I was hungry. Who cares? God needed you where you were so you could be where you are today in Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, so many people are bowed down and worn down with how they feel about themselves. They have low self-esteem. Yes, they know they're Christians, but they've had such a hard life. Forget about it. Stop looking at the flesh and start thanking God for where you are.
Amen.
The funny bit about that story was, I'm thinking, as I lay hands on this lady, if she falls backwards, she's going to squash this skinny little West Indian lady. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what are you going to do? And I laid hands around, and I took my hands off, and she spun round and went that way. And we're looking at each other. God has a plan and a purpose. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter who your parents are. It doesn't matter who your grandparents are. It doesn't matter one little bit. God has a plan and a purpose for your life. I'm nearly finished. God is not a heavenly emergency service. Oh, I've hurt myself. Get God to help me. Yes, He will, because He's God. But He wants us to be whole and hearty and strong and fit so we could live for Him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I pray for people, Lord, I want you to heal them. I don't care about the pain, Lord. I just want you to be glorified. I don't say that in front of them, but that's going on inside. But not when I pray for you today, obviously. No, he said, but as the commander of the captain of the Lord's army, I've come. This heavenly encounter preceded Joshua's first real test as a leader. He was never going to lead the children of Israel victoriously into battle. But God said to Moses, and later Jehoshaphat, the battle's not yours. It's not about you. It's not even about the tens and tens and tens of thousands of soldiers that you've got. The battle is the Lord. If you're battling today, it's not about you. Say, Lord, I'm living for you. I'm in a covenant relationship. You have a plan and a purpose for my life. And it doesn't include this sickness, this disease, this cancer, this debt, this problem. The battle is not yours, but the Lord's. In 1 Samuel 17, we know the story of David and Goliath. And our hearts are really on the little boy with the little stones and big Goliath, 19 feet tall, I don't know what he was about. But anyway, he was big. No matter how big he was big. He was so many cubits. And he had an armor bearer, and he had this shield, and he had all this stuff. And a huge army of Israel were terrified by him. He said, you send your champion, and I'll send our champion Goliath. And they were terrified. They stood trembling. A little shepherd boy, David, came to bring some food for his brothers. His brother said, what are you doing here? You're just a young boy. Go back home. And they were jealous of him because he'd been anointed by Samuel. But David had a different vision. He didn't see the huge Philistine army. He didn't see the hugeness of Goliath and the weaponry and the shields and this. He said, how dare this uncircumcised Philistine stand against the armies of God?
Amen.
In other words, Goliath is not in a covenant relationship with God, and he's standing against God's army. He didn't see anything else. And he said, I'm going to go and get him. And the king, Saul, said, well, here's my arm. He said, oh, I'm, that's no good. He went out there. I want to tell you, God didn't deliver Goliath for David's sake. God delivered Goliath because it was part of his plans and purposes for Israel and for us today. It wasn't about that. He wasn't there to assist or rescue David as he faced Goliath. But God saw to it that his rescue plan for Israel succeeded, that David's place in the kingdom was assured. Joshua would have wondered how he would take Jericho. He may have thought that he was on his own. He may have thought that he had to rely on the army and on the soldiers. He had forgotten that he had an invisible army from heaven at the ready. And it's the same for us today. It's lovely, this fan, but it's the same for us today. And the man said, I have come. God has sent him. And there might be times when you're facing trouble, spiritual trouble, physical trouble, health problems, financial problems, family problems, depression problems, whatever you may have. You might think, I'm all on my own. But you've got a great God.
Amen.
I'm all on my own, but God is working for you. I'm all on my own, but you're in a covenant relationship with God through the blood of Jesus, and he's given you promises. You can think, oh, I don't know how I'm going to get through. But God, God who is rich in mercy, God who is a God of compassion, God who is almighty. And Joshua's perspective was suddenly changed from looking at himself as the commander. He realized, actually, God is the commander. And as I allow God to be my commander, all of God's forces and resources will be mine. And it's the same for you and me today. Whatever you have to face, you've got God. That's why you can praise him in the difficulties. That's why you can sing when you face giants. The man was armed and dangerous. His sword was drawn. For us as we live for God, we walk in his authority, we're armed and dangerous. So often Christians think themselves as weak. How will we defeat terrorists? How will we defeat this problem? How will we sort out the problem with the migrants? It's not ours to sort out, it's God's. When this Brexit vote came around, I came to the conclusion, I didn't mind whether we stayed or went. I wanted to go, I voted to go, because I wanted to be, I was after sovereignty really. Why be ruled? As I said earlier, this week, coming week's Independence Day. You got independent from Britain. Now you're dependent on loads and loads of them. How many? 23 nations? God help us. Just thank God that Germany, who is the biggest financial power in Europe, the one who bombed your opera house, they're paying for all your new roads. Hallelujah. Come on, it's better than that. But we're never independent from God. If we are, we're in trouble. We have authority. As we pray, as we speak in Jesus' name. The same army that was available to Joshua in the spirit realm is available to fight God's battle on earth. If we are living fleshly, soulish Christian lives, we'll miss the triumph. Lastly, our place is to be humble. Take off your shoes. Well, not literally, please. Bow before the Lord. It's not your battle. It's not your will. It's God's.
Amen.
I want to pray for you. I don't hope the time is gone. Have I got a couple of minutes, Joe? We're all right. Why don't we just stand? I want you to pray after me. If you can't speak English, don't worry. Just don't worry. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that we're not on our own. Our lives are not just some hit or miss lives. Our lives are not hit or miss lives. I thought you were praying after me. Thank you, Father, that I'm living under thy direction of the Word of God. and of the Spirit of God. I thank you, Father, that you have a plan and a purpose for my life, for my family, and for my loved ones. And I step into place like a member of the army. I stand in my place in the name of Jesus to make a difference where I am, so that you can work out your plan and purpose in my life, in my church, in my family, and in my nation. In the name of Jesus. If you're sick in body or soul, maybe you're struggling. Maybe you have depression, heartache, whatever you've got, whatever you need today, God, not me, God is able to heal you.
Amen.
You just, as we just stand here, just take a moment to focus on Jesus. I love that verse that Paul writes in Philippians. My God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory in and through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
A lot of people think that's about finance. Well, that's part of it. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we just reach out to you. Thank you that you're the Lord I do. Holy Spirit, just come and just touch us today. Break through those strongholds of hurt, pain, sickness, circumstances. Lord, just release healing into our lives.
Amen.
I just speak in the name of Jesus and I command physical healing to take place right now. People with bad backs and with shoulders that are bad. In the name of Jesus, with hip problems, with knee and leg problems, with disc problems, in the name of Jesus, we just command healing. In the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. I think there's somebody here that has problems in the lung, with the breathing. In the name of Jesus, just heal that, Lord. Not in our name, but in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. You just check yourself out. Just say thank you, Jesus, even if the pain's not gone yet. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Maybe there's some of you that have heartaches. You're struggling. You're almost drowning under a sea of problems. Lord, let the peace of God come right now. In the name of Jesus, break that oppression, that depression. In the name of Jesus, release joy and peace into lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hallelujah. How are you?
Great.
Do be seated a moment. I'm going to have... Pastor Joe's asked me to sing those songs we did the other year. Anybody remember them? I need Sandra. It's great, Sandra. Are you going to bonk? Oh, you're going to make sure it's going. We're going to do the Wonderful God. We're going to do the Wonderful God. I'm going to do that song. We're going to do this great song by a friend of mine called Godfrey Myrtle. And it's about names and descriptions and titles of God. Well, that's all fantastic, but as we sing the chorus, just go for it, my wonderful God. All right? Praise the Lord.
My face to see the Lord, give my full attention.
set my face to see the Lord. I will set my face to see the Lord. Give my full attention to my God. I will listen for His voice. I will listen for His voice. My wonderful counselor, teacher, reminder, healer, my healer, my strengthener, repairer, finder, my Jesus, my Savior, my wonderful God. Forerunner and finisher, my conqueror, deliverer, restorer, my hammer, my fire, uniter, redeemer, my Jesus, my Savior, my wonderful God. Creator, creator, defender, my maker, instructor, commander, my warrior, my shelter, my helper, my leader, my Jesus, my Savior, my wonderful God. I will set my face to see the Lord. Give my full attention to my God. I will listen for His voice. I will listen to my shepherd. My shepherd, my gatherer, my fisher, my rewarder, my builder, my friend, my tempter, my spirit, provider, my portion.
They would have heard me say but this will not happen. Not because I'm a prophet, but because we read what's written in the Bible. And I can say that one of the most accurate teachers about eschatology, the end times, is now dead, Harry Smith. He's one of the most accurate on the things that are happening today. Okay? In America, they are planning that in 2 years, everybody will have his personal chip. Huh? So even if we are not accurate in this, but apparently it's in line in what we think is going to happen. So if this is so true, what I'm saying is true. Jesus is coming.
Very soon.
And we believe that Jesus is coming again. We better get our act, I might say, together. Let's get our Christian, let us get serious with our spiritual life, with our Christianity. And one of the most important things that we need to do is tell the people that we meet that Jesus is coming again. And unless they are born again, one thing is for sure, that they are going to die. If they die without Jesus, they are going to hell. It's not a popular message, but it's the whole truth. I like that Bob, Pastor Bob, mentioned about you are going to die. We are going to die. That preacher that you sent me the video, preached the sermon on, you are going to die. And you know what? That means you're going to have it. You're going to have it. If you're going to die, if you're born again, are you sure you're born again today? Then you are sure that when you die, you go to heaven. Amen. So praise God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Let's give glory to Jesus. Amen. Shall we stand? Pastor Paul, will you close with a benediction, please?
Father, we want to thank you for your wonderful God. We just pray for your peace and your blessing upon us and upon our loved ones. We want to glorify you. We want to be a blessing to people around us. So bless us in the name of Jesus.
Amen. We'll meet Tuesday for Bible study. Okay? God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the day.